Fucking Hippies and Pancakes. You recording?
Yeah, of course, we're live.
What's up? What's up? What's up, YouTube? Welcome to episode 60. The Nipsey episode of Hippies and Pancakes. It's the Hustle and Motivate episode. So all we talking about is motivation and of course some other shit, you know. That's all we talk about. But as usual, I got DJ Q Ways with me.
What's going on?
Got D with me.
What's up? What's up?
And you know, yeah, man. Shit, man. Me and Q were just talking shit. We had 60. 40 more, they're going to be on our nuts, man. After we finish these next 40, they're going to be ready for it. They're going to be trying to knock the door down. I'm trying to get Revolt to come holler at us. I need to get on Revolt with everybody else. Or Apple Music podcasting. They started the episode, though. Rest in peace, man. DMX, man.
Peace.
Yeah, that was
definitely
rest in peace to Doc, man. X, man. A lot of niggas, man. A lot of niggas, you know, I see a lot of people posting about him, but of course, you know, it's always that thought that, oh, this is a trend. I ain't gonna say that about him, though, because that nigga genuinely touched niggas' lives, bro. It don't matter if you was rich or poor. If you couldn't relate to this nigga, bro, I don't know. I don't know. But I seen the nigga, like I was telling Q, I was like, man, Funk Flex Jaw, like, went in on niggas. He was like, I see all these niggas posting all these pictures. They got 50 plus pictures with DMX and all this rest in peace shit. Where y'all was at when he was going through that shit?
Yeah, some of them. I hope he was there talking shit.
Yeah, no bullshit, right? Now, you know, his man really was Swizzy, though. You know, Swizz Beatz really was. That's the nigga, you know, like, that's really his friend. I was saying some interviews he was doing, you know, post, you know, during that shit right now. And he jived, like, we're just talking about a little time. Just everybody got the pretty much same general story and idea of DMX. Like, me, when I was a kid, I used to be terrified of this nigga, him ass Snoop Dogg. And Snoop Dogg did that to himself by playing Jimmy Bones, but... DMX, I was just scared of the nigga. I'm like, why is this nigga growling all the time? And then, you know, the nigga used to have some for the time period, he had some grim ass videos for real, like kind of dark. Yeah, so, but a lot of niggas don't give my man enough credit, like me and Cuba just saying, my man single-handedly saved Def Jam.
Facts.
And there's the reason that niggas got a job today.
If you was out at that time, you didn't have to give him credit. He took it. He was the number one artist. DMX was definitely the number one artist for a period of time.
But the nigga, like every time I say him, like, he always been so fucking humble about this shit. Like, even like, and he one of them rappers like that I watched get like older, I'ma say. But niggas still rap like I said. It's still, you know how some niggas got a style that kind of just like, I ain't nobody want to hear that no more?
Yeah.
You could still put DMX on the track you could have still put DMX on the track and you know, the nigga would have held his own, you feel me? Like, a lot of rappers ain't like that, yo. A lot of these rappers get old, that shit just be it. You be like, damn, nigga, you used to rap back and you was selling platinum?
Look up DMX Spellbound.
Huh?
DMX Spellbound. That's some 92 shit. 93. Spitting.
I think, hey, bro, was too nice though, man. I think it sucked that a lot of people, like, I mean, because you never really know until you watch these interviews and you get these different perspectives of shit too, because a lot of people will say something and it don't really be that. You know what I'm saying? Like I was telling Q, you know, we always talking before we start rolling this shit. We was talking about Cam'ron. And like, I liked Cam'ron growing up, right? But I ain't know that Cam was the business mind. Like, I always thought of Cam as like a street dude, like a hustler. But I ain't never think of him as like the business mind that he was until I watched this interview on Drink Champs. And he talk about, you know, how he even got to Rockefeller with the Rock time. and basically how he was saying like it was this one fucking mop closet or some shit that was in the office. Niggas weren't using Jones. So him and this, you know, him and Jim Jones, and then they clean the bitch out. Basically, they office and shit. And I can see why niggas would not want a man like him around. I can see why a weak nigga wouldn't want a nigga like him around for real, because you can be intimidated by so much ambition. You feel what I'm saying? Because you, when you see that somebody that you employ or that you feel like you know what I'm saying, you are empowered by them being a subordinate to you, when they start showing potential that they can be bigger than you, niggas don't be liking that shit. But Cam's whole angle was like, when I watched the interview, was like, it wasn't even like that. He already knew what he wanted to do. He was already driven. He already had the setup. So just, I'm not going to wait for nobody. And I feel like that about anybody. Like, nigga, if I get signed for that paper today, we not about to, oh, all right, we're going to go on cruise control. We got the money now. Like, now I'm about to turn this bitch up. This shit might disappear, or not even that. Like, nigga, it's here now. This will be asked for. It's time to turn it up.
That's right.
So, yeah, like, I definitely did. Like, because they ain't had blogs when the Dipset was hot. It wasn't really this. It was like radio.
You had to listen to the radio.
Yeah, you had to really listen to the radio to hear these niggas. And like, we was even at school. Like, you know, my mom wasn't trying to listen to no camera interview on the fucking radio. She ain't hear that shit.
He was playing that shit, man. That was radio. That's when you had to go through the DJs. It's so different now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but yeah, you had to listen to the radio. You had to, like the interviews, they would play them and replay them on different stations. When the new songs would come out, they would put the drops and the bombs. That's where the bombs and the drops and shit came in, so people wouldn't copy it off the radio, but you had to listen. There wasn't nowhere else to get it.
Yeah, like, cause I mean, I'm liking this new era, especially like with the quarantine, dude. Like, I feel like, you know, it's crazy. Like, when you think about timing and shit, like, everything that a rapper, any forward thinking rapper was thinking, and like the better rapper, you know, the rappers that did it during the quarantine, like started their podcast and shit. I feel like, you know, that let me know I lined up perfectly with what I'm supposed to be doing too. Cause like, we ain't know this joint was gonna hit, but this motherfucking quarantine hit and shut everything down and we still had something rolling. I noticed that, you know, not everybody can do this shit, man. Not everybody can do this shit. I've been catching some cool ass podcasts. Like I told bro, I love the Drink Champs. For some reason, that's like one of the better podcasts of all the podcasts. That's one of the best joints. One, cause Noriega has a fucking amazing personality. You know what I'm saying? Like, the nigga just, he lit. Like, every time I ever seen him growing up, like on videos or even in like Paid in Full, the nigga always, that's really this nigga character. Like, that's just really who he is. And I just like, I'm trying to, man, I ain't even gonna lie. I'm trying to get on that level, bro. Like, with this podcast and shit, man, these dudes be having like big sponsors, man. Like, big ass sponsors. But most importantly, like, they get to uncover some interesting shit, like some real interesting perspectives on shit, man. Cause these interviews have been clearing a lot of shit up for me. So much so, I don't even watch the news no more. I don't even care what's going on in politics.
Yeah, Biden ain't talking about shit.
Yeah, I was already bored with this nigga during the debates before he was the president. Like, I'm like, nah. I ain't gonna lie, we can get Trump another foe. Get that nigga another foe.
You voted for Trump?
Nah, I ain't vote for none. Neither one of them niggas. I don't.
Oh,
vote
yeah,
for
that's
me.
Right.
It ain't no voting for the lesser of two evils for me. I was watching the 85 South podcast with Chairman Fred Hampton Jr. Right. And he was talking to some regard, like, about how, remember we had talked about different, like, political movements from hip-hop as far as, like, the Vote or Die?
Yeah.
He said, man, that Vote or Die shit, that shit didn't even come into the state of Illinois. Like, all that campaigning, vote or die shit. He said they weren't doing that. They tell them niggas, nah, we ain't doing that here. Ain't no vote for the lesser of two evils here. Both of them niggas fucked up. We don't want neither one of them. And that's how a lot of niggas, like a lot of us, I think the thing
about the voting that I always say is we gotta vote so we make them give us stuff. But they give us stuff for our vote.
That's the whole kill today.
I'm listening.
Niggas voted for Biden for that very reason, technically.
He giving up shit.
So they say he voted for Biden for a certain reason. But look, ain't it funny how I've been biting my tongue on this and been not wanting to say this, but I'm going to say this shit. I find it funny that some Asians, no disrespect to the Asian community, I'm just for me. I'm for the people. You know what I'm saying? I'm for my people. Bruh, I ain't never seen shit get enacted so quickly. Like, they made it like federal laws. Like, they making federal mandates for Asian hate crimes when a few Asians get killed. Black people been getting killed since we touched down here. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And like, you don't see no legislation get passed so fast.
The legislation, but it took a lot for us to get it.
It's like they saying I just felt like it was, that's some Me Too shit. Like, oh, we dying too? Like, nah, nigga, nah. Like, y'all dying, that's fucked up. But like, it's fucked up when anybody dies. You know what I'm saying? But it's like, nigga, they is fucking, literally, they have a system to target us, my man. Like, it's a whole difference when you born an op to the system. You are like, you are birthed an op. You ain't did nothing to nobody. You cooing and shit. And you already an op. It's a whole difference. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, it bothers me when I'm riding around, I'm seeing the billboards. You know, like, I seen the Black Lives Matter billboards. That shit was cool. That don't do nothing. I mean, like, it make you feel cool being black, riding around saying Black Lives Matter, and you black. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, Black Lives Matter. It feel like something to me, but it don't change nothing. But when I seen that shit, bro, like, that shit happened, and they immediately responded to this shit. Like, buddy, your first days in office was supposed to go, what the fuck we gonna do about, fuck, they talking about, the country's divided, let's bring it together. You know, they was talking about Democrats and Republicans. They wasn't even talking about the people. You know what I'm saying? They wasn't even talking about the people. Like, they not at all. And I think it was this, I don't know what I was watching on YouTube, but somebody was saying, like, basically how these motherfuckers, you know, they class and they circle. That's how they think. They think within their class and they circle. When they make the laws, when they make these rules, they think about how it's affecting them or what's going on in their communities as far as what's happening in Martha's Vineyard, not what's happening in Berry Farms. You know what I'm saying? They don't think about the country as a whole. They thinking about these places that they built up with the money in them. You know what I'm saying? What is we going to do to protect our cash? You know what I'm saying? What is we going to do to protect what we buying? Like, they don't think about us not one bit. But when when it comes to being in this system today, I'm just like over paying attention to what they doing, all the voting shit. Niggas just need to get back to what Malcolm and them was saying. Do for self. Do for
you
self.
Gotta do that.
Just like niggas just got, it's not like it can't be done, because like, it's the same fight. And they say militarily, the Black Panther Party was defeated, but ideally it wasn't. And when I heard them say that, I understood, like, you know, like, you can't go up, even Huey Newton and say, when it come down to fighting them, and what you say, you know, what you be saying too, when it come down to fighting them, we ain't about to win no battle with them fighting them like that. You know what I'm saying? Straight up head on with guns. Nah, that ain't even the idea. The idea is for them, all of us, to be like a hive mind when it come to it, and really support and get the fuck about this shit. Like, crabs in a barrel can be a negative thing when we pull each other down, or it can be, nigga, you get to the top, hold the top, and the nigga from the bottom climb up. You know what I'm saying? It can be that too. It ain't always gotta be everybody, because everybody, we stuck in this crabs in the barrel mentality. You stuck in that mentality. You know what I'm saying? You ain't even thinking, you know what I'm saying? We can get about this shit together. You know what I'm saying? We only as strong as our weakest link. Niggas be, the thing is though, it's like right now though, like what it's always been. Like I said on Twitter, it's a COINTELPRO in the rap game too though. That's why they be buying niggas out. That's why they pay, you know, they planted Tekashi 6ix9ine in the industry. And he not the only one. He just the first one where it blew up. You know what I'm saying? But I think what that was is just let the other ones know, like, you know, it's okay. If you get caught, you're going to still have a career after.
Yeah, but he ain't really going to have no career. I mean, he did a little bit, but he about to go away.
That nigga made no money when he came on.
Because his song Stream, he had some streams and shit, but based upon, I don't know, like, he probably get money off of views on his Instagram and shit, selling shit like that. Make a little bit, but
like these niggas that be making the chains for him and shit, they all promoting this shit. I be seeing them like just scrolling.
Yeah.
It's like when I see that shit, it's like that one scene on Friday After Next movie. He's like, "You like that your son a fag?" Remember he said that shit to what he said about that. It's like, dang, you like that nigga snitch? Like what? Like you cool? You made that chain for him? Like I would have told nobody if I did that. Like I see if I'm trying to come up, it's a pandemic, nigga, try to get a couple million. Fuck it. Hey, you ain't getting this from me. Flat out. I would have been broadcasting that shit, yeah.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. Like them kids, that's a quick lick. You know what I'm saying? They don't know. They don't really care. That's just a quick lick for them. They all using him.
I also like this. I feel like you don't need to be bringing that shit into the music. This business over here. This rap shit, this business. No matter what a nigga say, all that, I'm going to get my story out. This business. You know what I'm saying? For real. Like, you want to get your story out, write a book. This business.
Yeah, because he got paid off them documentaries and shit.
Hey, the nigga Ye just got money for his. He sold his.
Hell yeah.
Ye said this shit what is in the making.
It was 30. Yeah.
He said
30 million.
Oh, 30 million?
Yeah.
Now, like, how long he been creating this? They say this don't been in the making for a minute.
Yo, Kanye West documentary about to be fired. That shit gonna be in the movies when movies open back up.
Okay.
All the crazy. But see, there's the thing, like I said about Kanye, he playing with history. You know what I mean?
But it... Ain't nobody thinking like Ye though. I kind of watched some of his interviews over the last week. Just think, like, you gotta really sit and listen to a motherfucker. You can't let other motherfuckers explain to you what a motherfucker said and meant, you know? And I went and listened to something. Niggas definitely, that's what I was saying. Niggas be getting caught up in, niggas got in their own way. They put themselves in their own way. They choose to stay where they at. You can say, and the proof to that is a drug dealer who turns himself into a billionaire businessman. You feel what I'm saying? Like niggas, life is full of choices. You know what I'm saying? You gotta choose to want more for yourself and choose. You can't just think that shit gonna just be handed out to you. And like, I think that a lot of with Kanye, maybe sometimes I feel like he got a colorful way of saying this shit and people just be butthurt, because sometimes a nigga can be too blunt for motherfuckers. Niggas swear to God they like the truth until they hear that shit raw and they ain't like, oh, I don't like that. You should have said it this way. You know what I'm saying? He was like, yeah, I mean, I know it's
Kevin Sanders.
I know it's burgundy, but I would have been more comfortable if you would have said like dark red.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, nah, nigga, that's burgundy, bro. Like burgundy. You know what I'm saying? Like niggas don't like that shit sometimes. And it's like the nigga do be tripping, but that goes back to trying to speak in a coded language. Cause like, if you want to stay alive and tell the truth, you got to make the people think you crazy. That's the only...
That's deep right there.
The only way that you're going to be able to stay alive and tell the truth, bro, because it's like, who going to listen to that crazy-ass nigga down the street? But then, meanwhile, this crazy-ass nigga in the process why money was being handed over, when we talk about this big power shift and how this wealth gap increased, who was on...
Who became a billionaire?
Who was on the winning? Who put himself in a position not only to be able to run for president and put himself on the same ticket against a nigga that everybody was against?
And but, got himself in the conversation and got votes, because Donald Trump ain't win his first time or his second time or his third.
Hey, and then this. Who put himself in a position to help the same people that this the same nigga that sat in the fucking president's office on national TV in front of everybody and said, Larry Hoover. That alone, those two words, those two names alone was enough to make you think like, it gotta be something more with this nigga. Like, Dick Gregory, bruh.
He told me to free Kodak. Let his ass up.
Dick Gregory used to talk real, like he'd say some shit that's on point, and he'd be like, what? And then he'd be like, that's what I'm talking about. And you'd be like, huh? And if you was listening, you'd be like, mm-hmm. I seen that. You know what I'm saying? Throw the people off right quick. Make them think you nuts. Make them think you nuts. Every fucking genius in history so far was considered like what, crazy or had some shit going on with them.
New ideas are always called crazy at first. Every new idea. Imagine the motherfucker that thought about the telephone.
No, imagine the motherfuckers that thought about starting the Black Panther Party for self-defense.
But that's more like how you know gangs and shit formed. You had to protect yourself.
Yeah, but I'm saying like when you talk about crazy ideas, like what is the spook who sat by the door? Who is he supposed to look like?
Supposed to look like you. Supposed to look like me.
Kanye look like me. Kanye look like you. Except his bag different, where he can really fight. He can really... Niggas in positions to buy satellites at this point. Like, ain't no telling who's a super fan of Kanye and the government that he know now. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Make a connection.
Because you got a job don't mean you don't like Kanye West.
That's why I like what Jay-Z, what Tim and Swiss, what everybody's doing with their companies. Like we said before, they did it. You build it up, and then you sell what you have for a part of what they have. So now every time they get paid, you get paid. Instead of every time you get paid, they get paid. What's up?
Yo, I got a nigga that you said that. We gonna go back to this conversation, but I got a nigga that we gonna get on here, bro. I'm gonna tell you what he did.
All right.
I don't know. I ain't gonna say that. The nigga, so he got a video and he released it as an NFT.
Yeah, I'm trying to get on the NFTs. Let's get him on. I want to learn how to do it.
I know how I can tell you. This for anybody. This the Hustle and Motivate episode, so I'm gonna give away some free game. First of all, in order to create an NFT, you need Ethereum. You can't purchase it with any other crypto. You can't use any other crypto. You need Ethereum. So one, that's a major key for you and I. You feel me?
I thought you had to mint it.
You do have to mint it, but you need that's with the currency that you need.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Like, as far as like, you know, paying for shit, like it's like you basically NFT is you buying a license. You license at something.
It's like a digital
license.
A copyright, right?
Yeah, it's a digital copyright, basically. So yeah, that's exactly what it is. Actually, this just all this shit is like basically this new money shit. Everybody's so confused, but it's not confusing when you think about it. This new money shit is just the internet. It's the internet. It's that simple. Stop making it complicated. It's the internet, nigga. Like it's the internet. It's online. That's it. So basically, it's like you gotta use the crypto to go and have them mint the shit for you, and then you go, and then that's when you're able to start trading that shit on a blockchain.
Right.
So I had an idea, and anybody who you know listening, this free game. This if you fucking with the podcast, you're gonna get free game right here. If you're smart, knowing that that's what the process is, I think that it would behoove you to own one entire coin of Ethereum at least as an asset. You know what I'm saying? Because every time that someone has to go and mint, they're going to need Ethereum $100 worth, which is only a percentage, basically boosting what you already own. You know what I'm saying?
Let's get it.
And they not at their cap yet. They not actually... I don't think Ethereum is set to hit like a cap for real, like how it's like a limit on Bitcoin.
Yeah, it's a limit on Bitcoin. You can make more Ethereum, I believe.
But I've been doing some research, but Bitcoin Cash just said to have that's one of the top leading cryptos right now too. And they said they said to have a cap too. So they predicting to be doing they was at like 5-6 something last week. I'm pretty sure they're doing better now. But they was talking about projecting like $1,100, you know what I'm saying? Like in the next like 18 months type shit. And it's for one coin, you know what I'm saying? You're gonna double by next year. If you invest now, for real. So that's just some free game, you know, as far as ownership, because like niggas gonna be making transactions like, oh, he told me how to make an NFT. You could have learned that on YouTube. But as far as, you know, the bigger picture, that's for me and us. I'm just going to put us on the game. Like, niggas going, everybody go on one. And then on the back end, when we going in and going to mint our shit, we got one on the side that we actually invested in. Every time we go and make these transactions, we making our sales money too.
Right, because every time we use it, the price goes up or the scarcity. I feel you.
You feel what I'm saying? So, like, that's free game for anybody that want to hit that because, one, obviously, you know, I'm already hip to it, so it might be I might be involved, I might not be, but that's one idea because that's the whole idea behind Bitcoin. Like if you didn't get in when it was low or you don't have $60,000 or whatever the case is to purchase one coin, if it's one for sale for you, then you know, like you lost. And these not even the only joints, like it's other cryptos that's like they call altcoins. You know, it's other altcoins and shit that's really getting money too. Like real live getting money, like flipping fast on a daily basis.
If you was an ADA fucking 3 months ago, your shit fucking went up 100 times. That shit went from 0.111 to $1.20.
Yeah. See, what's crazy, because back in the day when I first started fucking with like Robinhood and shit, that was the first shit that I had started spending my money on. Because I didn't like stocks. I went to school, like the stock market crashed and niggas went crazy. I'm like, I don't trust that shit. Like it ain't, I mean, because like the crypto is the same way, but you kind of like earn your interest and you get a return on your investment way faster. At a higher percentage, you know what I'm saying? Like that shit really be coming back. Like when you investing in this other shit, your shit ain't paying dividends. You ain't really making no dough for real. Like I be fucking with Walmart because Walmart is the lead competitor to Amazon as far as the online sales and the stores and shit, leading competitor. And you know Walmart. If anybody know anything about Walmart, Walmart be pressing shit. Walmart press shit. Walmart are some big dogs. Motherfuckers are taking shit off their shelf if you play with them. Drop the price or that shit coming off the shelf.
Yeah, Yeah, but shit, you selling in mass, so it's worth it.
Huh?
When you selling with Walmart, you gotta have scale. Like when them patty pies hit the shelves, then they couldn't stay on the shelves.
Yeah.
Yeah, I sell them motherfuckers for $2 a piece. Or what they wouldn't even $6 a piece. They probably make cost $2 to make. You couldn't keep them on shelves. Patty pies.
Walmart is the trappers of the year. And whoever owns Walmart, Lowe's, and Sam's Club, they trappers of the century.
Walmart owns Sam's Club, Sam Walter.
Yeah, they own Sam's and Lowe's, right?
I'm not sure if they own. They might, because
they all on the same chain.
Yeah, so they do then, yeah.
Because I remember, back in the day, the Sam's Club that was in Landover, that's when I first got hip to this shit. I ain't never really paid attention to business. I used to just go into a lot of stores because my dad used to go to stores all the time. But I used to peep mergers and shit. Like when Sprint bought Nextel, I always paid attention to mergers and shit, bro. Or like chains and who own all this shit. Like, hey, Young, what y'all think about that Paul Pierce shit, bro?
Like they said it's cause he put it out, but I mean he don't really he ain't tripping like he hurting.
I asked about how he feel. Also barbershop talk shit.
That's a Tuesday.
Like, you would say what?
I don't know why he's showing it off though. You know what I mean? Like all the niggas in the back, they was just chilling doing that thing. You could show the video.
He probably like, man, what a time to be alive, man. Like,
but that's what I'm saying. The thing about it is, with me, when I look at, like I said, it seemed like a Tuesday. It's like, they overreacted to the shit. It wasn't nothing. He ain't did nothing wrong. He in Cali smoking weed,
smoking a little weed.
None of the girls is naked. Everybody smiling, having fun. You know what I'm saying? What he did wrong. That's how I feel about it.
Because you know what it could have been, though? You want to know some G shit, and this is me having a conversation with you. I'm Paul Pierce. I got all this going on. What if it was some shit like, hey, these bitches in there drunk. Let me put this shit on camera so they don't be trying to say we raping tonight.
Yeah, hey, could have did that. That's what I'm saying.
Never know. Like, shit, nigga, I respect the game. Hey, you got to think like this. What the fuck do that mean that ESPN dropped him?
Nothing.
We still gonna support him. Start a podcast. I'm gonna watch it.
Exactly. And he
smoke
some
weed
in
your podcast.
He got like 20 offers. Motherfucker. Yeah, Cam Soda said they're paying $250 to just get with some girls and live stream and shit and smoke weed. $250 just to talk about basketball. Watch the game.
He could be my co-host. Shit, you can host HippiesNdPancakes with me. Shit, Paul Pierce, you good over here, fool. What you say? Hey, what you say, D? Tuesday night.
Tuesday night, bro. Tuesday night.
I ain't gonna lie.
The game
though.
Come on Tuesday, Friday.
Yeah, Titty Tuesday. You know what I'm saying? Taco Tuesday.
Hey, Pink Taco Tuesday.
He definitely wasn't doing nothing that no other nigga even wasn't doing or wasn't thinking about doing on Tuesday. I was probably doing just that on Tuesday, just now with all the females and shit. I probably just was by myself getting hired up. Like, at this point, they could have tried that shit with, like, Ricky Williams, you know? I'm like, bro, this is done deal, nigga. Everybody smoke weed now, bro. What's the nigga name? Shannon, what's his name? The nigga be having the do-rags on and the backwoods and shit. I'm like, how come he can do all this kind of shit, but this nigga can't smoke weed?
He on Fox, but I think what it is, maybe.
But I'm saying, like, what do it matter?
By Disney. I don't know what the ethical, maybe because he was using drugs or appeared intoxicated on video. I don't even know what he did that was wrong. That's what I'm saying. They just released him because he was chilling with some chicks.
His way out. He probably was like, you know what? Fuck Disney. Fuck ESPN. I'm out, man. Ain't no telling what kind of, you know what's funny? When you think about, I was talking about Cameron, right? Cameron talk about how he had to get out his deal, right? His first deal. So he said he used to go to the label every day with like 40 niggas. Like just be obnoxious as fuck. Every day he had niggas in there eating your food, answering your phone, all kind of shit. Just housing that job, making niggas uncomfortable.
Right.
Niggas be, because niggas, you don't realize sometimes you gotta avoid the contract to get out of it. You know what I'm saying? You gotta avoid
that loophole. That is a perfect point. If he wanted to do something else, then he in contract, let me out.
Yeah, and you gotta understand, like Disney and them, I'm just saying, you know, kind of like them big corporations, some kind of slave deals when you think about it, because they got the most leverage. They got the platform to put you in front of every fucking body. You know what I'm saying? Like Disney Plus on every TV, nigga, ESPN on every phone, Disney Plus on every phone. You feel what I'm saying? Like, you're going to be everywhere.
That is a great point, because he signed a deal. He been on a contract, and what they ain't trying to renegotiate. All right, let me out then. I'm out. Peace, King.
Especially when you know that outside that contract, independently, you can make more money and receive a bigger end. You know what I'm saying? Bigger profit, bigger back end.
When you see Matt Barnes and Steven Jackson up in all the smoke, they smoking with the players and shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, come on, bro.
Yeah,
sponsored by the network, owning this shit. They're part of the the Black Effect with Charlamagne for the audio.
I'm pretty sure this nigga can reach out.
Come on,
this nigga can reach out to Jay-Z and get a motherfucking podcast on Tidal, man. I'm pretty sure that.
I'm telling you, whatever you want to do, he's able to do it. So I think that's what I'm saying. I think it made Disney look crazy because all of the bullshit in their past, all of the racist bullshit,
racism and shit, like fuck y'all. That's what
crazy,
I was thinking.
Wild
like,
shit, they sexualizing kids and shit.
Mm-hmm.
Making all the girls want to be princesses and not having real standards of the real world and life and shit. You know what I'm saying? Disney got a whole lot of fucked up shit with them.
Yeah, and then they try to show my girl, Princess Tiana. She just coming from the slums with a nice hand. She can cook and shit. Like, nah, fuck that. Fuck that.
You always got to do more, man. Look, they used to tell us that in fucking school. I grew up in Chocolate City. You know, like, when it was still Chocolate City, everybody was Black. They used to tell that, like, the principal would have us in the auditorium and tell us that, like, look, you gotta be better than the white people. They're gonna count it against you. It was like open, you know what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't nothing to say. Like, I don't understand why people act different now. Like, you always had to be better, man. Fuck that shit. Be better.
Yeah, you know what's crazy is when I started doing my research on history, right? And I'm doing my research on the Panthers, and you know, like, I know I might have told y'all before, but maybe I didn't. But like, I've been involved in a lot of our history, in our history. Like, I've been personally involved. Like, I've marched and raised money. Not personally, I was there. And that's why I say I, because as a child, I wasn't on a playground. I was here doing this. I've marched for fucking H. Rap Brown and different political figures in our history. And I was thinking about, you know, I just went back and, you know, based on the things I've been through, I started researching some of the stuff that I stood beside to make sure that this is something I still support as a grown man. And I do. And I went and did some history on James Brown and H. Rap Brown and how, you know, they used to, you know, James Brown was out here doing this motherfucking thing on these white people, bro. I ain't gonna lie, bro. He was doing his thing on these white people. But they said that H. Rod Brown pushed up on him, you know what I'm saying? The Panthers pushed up on him, and that's how we get Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. That's how we end up getting that song.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, niggas gotta hold everybody to a standard like that. Like, bro, you gotta do at least one Black Power song. We ain't doing that. We gonna make it so this shit gonna be it. This is what we on. This is what the fuck we on. Everybody gotta get held to a higher standard. Yeah?
You see Jay-Z here?
With the nappy locks. It's Cam Newton.
My man, he drank that Beyonce lemonade and cut his head since.
You see my shit. Nigga, you know why? Because, like, I ain't gonna lie, like, when you want to talk about, like, influence and shit, I was influenced by Weezy, and not like the, and I'm not saying that because of my dreads and my tattoo. I was influenced by Weezy because Weezy was breaking stereotypes. You know what I'm saying? He was breaking barriers for a nigga. Like, in my mind, I grew up with Lil Wayne. Like, right. You feel me? Like, I grew up with Wayne. Like, I don't care what no other kid, no other nigga in this world say. Best rapper, nigga. Best rapper. On your ass, nigga. Like, yeah, him. Still to this day. And I realized, pay attention to, like, you know, this nigga Weezy, bro. This nigga was over fucking dedicated, bro. Over fucking dedicated, my nigga. And was always doing right, bro.
Look, you motherfucker. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, people be like, oh, what's the formula to get on? Do what Lil Wayne did. Take everybody's song and cook their ass on it. All of them. Like, all of them. Like, every day, it was a new Lil Wayne verse. Flaming shit. No bullshit. It was a period, like, every 2 weeks, you at least get a new... He would, on a mixtape or something, just kill shit for, like 2-3 years when he was on his Best Rapper Alive shit.
Yeah.
Like, when he was like, I'm the best rapper alive, and people was like, who the fuck is Lil Wayne calling himself the best rapper alive, till when he was like, Lil Wayne is the best rapper alive. It was like a 2-3 year run. About 3 years it took. Rap every day on take other people's beats and kill them shits. Do it. And you...
Nah, for real. Even when he started doing, like, rock and roll, though, that's when I knew that we was transcending boundaries. You know what I'm saying? I was like, oh yeah, it ain't no limit to what we can do. They can't say, can't no nigga say can't do nothing. When Weezy did a rock album, and I like the rock album, you feel me? I like Rebirth. Like, I don't care about who wrote what, none of that. This nigga did a nice rock album. Like, I don't listen to rock, but he made me listen to a rock album. You know what I'm saying? Like, real shit. I ain't gonna lie. Me growing up, I ain't listened to too much shit. Like, I'm not influenced by it. It's not too many niggas who I can say influenced me. Like, the two niggas that influenced everything about my rap style is Jay-Z and Lil Wayne. I don't need no other influences, for real, for real. Everybody else nice. I compliment them and shit, but it's nobody in my mind that's better than these two niggas. You know what I'm saying? And so much so that Lil Wayne even look up to Jay, and Jay look up to Lil Wayne. So I'm like, well, shit.
You don't look up to him. They probably look eye to eye.
You know what I mean. When I say look up, I mean they show admiration.
Right. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He'd be like, yeah, that shit was fire. That shit was fire. Everybody say Lil Wayne best bar is that better with better practice safe sex.
Oh yeah.
And wear latex.
Because you don't want the latex, and I think I'm latex. So
I don't think that's his best bar though.
This nigga said Charlotte would probably be the eye cookie in the past. The man probably get crushed by the building. I'd have jumped out of the building. I'd have jumped out the feeling of me being a shit because I was leaving skid marks on everywhere I sit. I'm everywhere I'm in. Like, I can go anywhere.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
this nigga used to cut that.
Hey, when he said real G's moving silence like lasagna. Hey, yo, it took me
mine
like,
so shocked. I was like, what around and really? Cut my head off.
I was like, I don't get it. Really? Yeah, exactly. Nigga,
no, mine so sharp, I fuck around and cut my head off. Fuck me up, my nigga. Like, exactly. My mind so sharp. You can't even fathom the the vividness of what he said, my nigga. Like, imagine a video with, you know what I'm saying? Nigga, head falling on. Like, nigga, that's how sharp my mind is. And then he do the video. I'm looking like, bro, hey, yeah, this nigga was real live flaming, bro. Nori asked him what was his favorite, his favorite mixtape, right? The nigga said the Dedications or No Ceilings. I said that's the two joints we were saying on here. That's his best shit for real, for real.
I mean,
no Dedications. He said any Dedications. He was like any. He said any joint. He was like any Dedication, whichever one.
When that nigga did the Georgia Bush. Georgia.
Hey, I ain't going out, bro. You know, that's what's crazy about hip hop, bro, is I'm not from the South and shit like that. But at that time, listening to Lil Wayne and knowing and like just thinking about activism, bro, niggas be mad at Weezy but forgot what Weezy did. You know what I'm saying? When they hit us. They hit us in Louisiana. But niggas don't realize that they think, oh, it was just a flood. Nah, nigga, they wiped out some black people, bro. Poor black people. They took out a whole class of people.
Drowned. Lil Baby, John probably got more radio play, but listen to Georgia Bush if you never heard it.
Nah, I heard that, John.
I shit know fire. You did. I'm not talking to you.
Oh, you talking about the listeners.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Catch up on some Lil Wayne. This is Georgia Bush.
Them niggas, that nigga right there, bro. Like when they all that shit, man. That going sitting next to Trump. How y'all gonna be? Y'all forgot what the fuck Eazy-E did.
I need them fair charges drop.
Did they forget what
Eric make Wright America did? Great again?
But did they forget what nigga Eazy-E did? This nigga gave money to, he donated money to them, and it was dripping in the fucking White House.
Right.
Fuck is you talking about?
Curling the White House.
Fuck you talking about?
But this is the thing nowadays. Motherfuckers don't know nothing. Like, I don't know if it is. I think they consume so much new media, you don't get a chance to consume and realize history. You know what I'm saying? It's so much new shit happening every day. When do you get a chance to go back and listen to the classics? It's so much new music. It's, you know what I'm saying? When are you going to do it?
It ain't even sometimes. I think the thing with Weezy is with everybody is like a lot of people just feel like his decisions they don't like. So that's why they want to discredit his music out their mouth. Because in their mind, they know. But out their mouth, they be, oh, shut the fuck up.
Lil Wayne is the person that slowed down the G-Unit.
Lil Wayne is Drake.
Yes, Lil Wayne is Drake and Nicki Minaj and Tiger and Rick Ross and fucking anybody who came after him.
Weezy handed me the ball and I ain't fumbled it yet.
Yeah.
Which means that he still got the ball, and if he decided to pass it back to Wayne, then what?
Wayne, he got his situation straight, but I mean, it's about nigga, do Wayne do that him, now?
Look,
you know what I'm saying, dude, he want to do that now. He did
Wayne,
it.
When you get to levels in this life, do you realize the stuff that get handed to you when you are Michael Jackson is the type of nigga that you ain't gotta really had no money when you Michael Jackson, because niggas gonna give you everything. Hey, Michael Jackson, you want a fucking Ferrari? You know what I'm saying?
Lil Wayne say, I'd rather spend time with my kids than time in the studio now sometimes. And that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah, I mean, he been in the game since he was fucking 9.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. So I can't fault him for not even putting forth the same thing that made him the best rapper alive, because he had
the
studio to do
it. But this the thing, though. It was effortless. That's the whole kill. So when he do it now, it's like, it's still him. You know, niggas not having the money.
You tell Eminem, I gotta Google my shit that I, whenever I think of something, I'm like, did I say that before? I gotta Google my own lyrics. Like, yeah, because he said everything.
Yeah, no bullshit.
Eminem said, I got to do the same thing. Yeah, got to Google my own lyrics. Did I flip this before?
No bullshit. But look, you know what? I was speaking of shit like that, listening to Jay-Z's verse What If It Was Like With Nipsey.
Yeah.
And when he says, I arrived on the day Fred Hampton got... Hey, every time I think of that, I was like, you not a real hip-hop fan if you don't know why that part of the verse was so fire when he did that, because he flipped the old verse. Because remember, he had the old joint. He said, I arrived on the day Fred Hampton died. Real niggas just multiply. They say December 21st, I'm supposed to die, so I'm out here celebrating my post-demise. You never heard that shit?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so when I hear that shit, and I hear people rappers do shit like that, I used to be real conscious of trying to not recycle my own shit until I realized that's how you get them on. You know what I'm saying? Like, you gotta get like
a callback.
Shit like that is just as important as having a fire hook. You gotta have a fire little punch that you be using every now and again. So niggas be like, oh, I love when he say that. That part right there. When he do that, you know it's the verse about to go away. You know what I'm saying? Like, hey man, I heard that shit. I'm like, yeah, this nigga Weezy though, I don't understand. Like, I would have best stopped rapping, bro. He probably got illest music, he still ain't released.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, do he want to do that again? You know what I mean? He got the money, he getting the residuals, he got his publishing straight. You know what I'm saying? He sold this, he got his checks, he got his affairs. Or do you want to do that?
They said
he'd rather play with his kid.
They said nigga Kodak Black said he got endless songs ready right now.
Put the motherfuckers out. But Kodak signed, right? Yeah, Kodak signed, so he gotta wait. He gotta get approval. That's why.
I like Kodak as a rapper, but I like him more. I'm more interested in him outside of rap now. Like, I think Kodak should do, like if Kodak had a podcast, I would watch that shit. That shit would be cool. That should be fun. Hey, he could be my co-host. That should be funny as shit. We get Kodak back as the co-host on Hippies and Pancakes. This nigga, y'all, he'll be making guests uncomfortable and shit, y'all. That should be funny as shit, bro. Ain't no bullshit. Talk about awkward gestures, huh, Q? Niggas gonna be looking like, cut that shit. Don't say that.
Yeah.
Mark it here? Nah. But yeah, man, I ain't gonna, I don't know, man. I'm really trying to tap into this motherfucking crypto money, man. All the way, man. I'm telling you, I've been schooling this shit out myself, bro. Like, I've been schooling this shit out myself. Like,
yeah.
I mean, because this money moving, man. It's like
a motherfucker.
I'm going to be looking for no get-rich-quick shit. Like, I'm all for the long haul, for real, because how I move anyway, you know what I'm saying? Like, the type of nigga I am, when you know financial literacy and you assess how you move with money, I'm a stacker, for real, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm a squirrel. I don't really play, for real.
Well, I mean, you can, look, stacking is fine, but you just don't want to stack in a depreciating asset. And cash is a depreciating asset.
That's why I already understood, right? When we had that conversation before, and that's why I made my first plays after that and shit. Like,
buy some gold or something, shit. I don't care. You can save, but saving something that's a limited commodity, stock, you know what I'm saying? Something that's going up in value. Gold then tripled since the fucking, I think doubled or tripled since the fucking, what's it called? What we doing right now? Quarantine.
It just depends. Ain't no more quarantine than we outside.
Whatever it is. It's been double since then. Diamonds are okay, but they're not really a good investment unless you have the right color cut. The triple C shit. Color cut clarity.
Clarity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Gold. Like, because diamonds aren't really that rare. Diamonds are controlled by an international cartel, De Beers. All this shit is well known, well documented, but they still let it go on. Anyway,
Hold on, so diamonds ain't really hitting on that for real.
No, as far as their rarity, no. No, they were rare. They were a rarer stone back in the day. They are the hard. It is the hardest stone, but it's a lot of diamonds now. Like, it's
because niggas probably harvesting them joints and using, you know what I'm saying, vibrations and science to.
You know what I'm saying? It's a whole new, a lot of new technology. It's an artificially controlled marketplace. Yeah, I mean that's. But it is. They release a certain amount every so often, you know what I'm saying?
But you know what? That's not a bad thing though. Like what you just said, this whole setup is an artificially controlled marketplace.
Yeah, I'm just saying they didn't have the same value as of 150 odd years ago when it became a part of the engagement ring. Because your ring used to just be a precious metal band. It didn't have a stone on it. But De Beers, it was a whole marketing campaign. It's a whole documentary about this shit, actually. How diamonds became what they are today. Like, it's not a historical value, and it's not based on scarcity. So it's just based on, it's based on artificial scarcity. Because like I said, they release only a certain amount so often. But invest in gold. Invest in Bitcoin or some cryptocurrency. Don't leave your money in the bank because inflation means your money is worth less than it is, than any rate of return on any fucking savings account, and your checking ain't getting shit. So don't leave your money in there because you're losing money leaving it in there. And the bank is making money. The more they have in there, there's more capital that they have to loan out. And they give you fucking fractions of pennies on the returns that they make on the money that you invested it in, deposited in the bank. That's cool with you? Like, you let me hold $100. I say, I'm going to give it back. I loaned this $100 to this other nigga. He gave me $150 back. I take the 150 and I'm gonna give you your 100 and I'm gonna give you 102. I'm gonna give you $102.
And niggas be working like shit. That's why I kind of move the money around. When you say that to me, it really, a lot of the shit I realize is based on, you just gotta do research. Like, a lot of people are not sure, but just peep the, go look at the history of the coin and see how it's grown, you know, how it's risen and fallen. And then, you know what I'm saying, I basically make my determination based on history versus what's right in front of me right now. That's how I make my prediction for what I want to invest money in. Like, generally, if you want to play in the stock market and you don't know what to invest in,
why would you like,
you know, you should invest in shit that, I personally would invest in shit that's gonna pay you some dividends. Cause like, that's just free bands every quarter. And then it's low key a sure thing depending on what you invest in or who you invest in. Cause companies gonna pay their bread out to their shareholders.
Yeah, definitely you get some dividend stocks. That's a good, man, if I was smart, man, all that money I was spending in the club, I would have been buying fucking Walmart stock.
I'm telling you, I would have never started drinking alcohol. I would have
like
been
a motherfucker.
I would have just been broke.
When I was 21, like, come on, bro. All that money I was spending on that bullshit, I could have just been buying fucking Walmart and Best Buy, Amazon stock to pay dividends to Disney and Apple.
Computers were like a thing in the earlier 2000s too, for real. But it was like, niggas didn't know how big the internet is going to be or was going to become.
We did. It's just, we didn't know. Like
niggas was passive with this shit, for real.
No, I didn't understand what truly investment was and how to make it return. I thought it was more of a gamble And it is a gamble, but if you understand it, it's a safe, it's safer than putting your money in the bank. Like, because again, you lose money by leaving your money in the bank because inflation is going up crazy and it's currently being artificially suppressed because of the COVID. But interest, man, interest rates, all these shit's about to boom. Like, all right, we're gonna see how it goes.
All right, so when people say, but I don't want people to think that when you say don't have your money in the bank, man, and don't have any digital dollar, like dollar, actually dollar currencies in an account, because that's how you gotta make some transactions. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you need
you gotta diversify your money.
You need a I'm saying you shouldn't have your savings. Why? Put that into a secure investment. You could put it into a bond or a CD or some shit. Like, if you go to bank, don't just leave it in a savings account, because what you getting on the return?
Mm-hmm.
Fucking 1.1, I mean, what, 1.25% or some shit like that. That's a high yield business savings account. Like,
so, I don't know. What exactly is a CD?
CD is a certified deposit. You could use it as a it becomes a fucking collateral. You could use it as collateral for shit.
Like how?
It's basically like same, just like if you have, it's like it's certifying that you have this money here and it's not moving. Like, you got to cash in the CD. It takes, it's like another process. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So you can put that up against, like, if you needed to purchase a loan or buy a car or something, it's like a, it's like a, like if you had a house, it's collateral.
Okay.
You can use a CD as collateral.
But how would that help? How would that help a person invest in that?
I mean, really? Like, you, it gains interest. It gains interest at a higher rate. It's a certified deposit.
Okay.
Yeah. So, because I think you have to hold the CD for a certain term. So it's like, all right, like a 6-month term, a 1-year CD, a 2-year CD, or whatever. So it's like, this money is going to be here for this long. So they're going to give you a higher rate of return on the money.
Cause it, they for sure, cause you for sure leaving it there for them to flip and shit,
right? Or you're gonna pay a penalty on when you cash it out. It's a certified deposit. I'm certifying that this money is here for this time.
I wonder why bank tellers don't tell you that when they sign you up
about the CDs and stuff.
Yeah.
Again, the bank makes money when you. Why would they want to give more money back?
This is a sensitive episode. This is the Hustle and Motivate episode. So, you know, all this free game, I'm going to ask questions that niggas might have, because
a bank is a business.
Mm-hmm.
They want to make money. Like, if you have a bit, like, hey, I opened up my business account, they offer me all kinds of money. So start your LLC at a young age. Get you a slogan, copyright that slogan. You put that shit on any jewelry you buy. You can write that jewelry off. It's all kinds of shit you can do. You know what I'm saying? Put it on the shirt. Put it like, make you put it on your clothes. Now all your clothes, you can write all of that off. Put it on your car. Now you can write all that shit off. You know what I'm saying? What's your favorite saying? Put that shit on your car. Put that car in your business name. Write that bitch off.
Nah, for real.
Yeah, that's promotion.
I ain't gonna lie.
Free game.
This shit a rabbit hole, man. When we start talking about this money, and I hope I hope niggas get inspired listening to, especially this episode, because like,
but
I was doing real research and I gave out some real game that I really want to start selling games to niggas, you know what I'm saying? Because game is sold, not told.
You feel me? But it's like everything you should be able to write off. Like like Warren Buffett, he eats breakfast. He'll eat breakfast and have a telephone conversation. Now my breakfast is paid.
Main nigga paying to talk to you and all that shit. You need to talk to me for how long? 15 minutes? All right, give me 20,000. What's up?
Well, that's when you're a consultant and stuff like that. That's a whole career. You want to be a consultant? But to be a financial consultant, you have to have a certain certification. Like, it's just like law. You cannot, you legally cannot advise people on how to, what to do with their money unless you have these financial certifications. Just like you legally cannot give advice on law unless you have a law license.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So if you're doing that, you can be held liable. That's why, like, on YouTube and shit, like, I'm not a lawyer or a financial advisor. Don't take none of this advice. This is not financial. Let me just say that real quick that we are recording.
That was a disclaimer.
Yeah, disclaimer. I am not a lawyer or a financial advisor. Do your own research, but these are things that I have heard may work.
That's all I do. Like, I take shit I learned, do some research, come back, feed it to the people. Like, hey, this is what I came with. This is where the lake at.
Yeah, but we're not lawyers or financial advisors.
Definitely not a lawyer or financial advisor.
Right.
Yeah, but I am a revolutionary.
That's right.
I am a revolutionary. Just a new revolution, too, man. Hey, it's the same revolution, though, man. We got organized, and the one thing is, we do need the money, but we don't got to chase it the way we chase. Like, niggas chasing the money to flash the money, like, that's cool too, I guess, or whatever, but nigga, get the bread for real. Like, really have
the bread, build a legacy first. Secure your legacy.
We could talk about that next week. I'm going to write that down because Yeah, legacy came across me, like, that's a concept that we don't have, and people don't understand that when you hustle for your last name and you hustle for your legacy, it's a whole different game.
It's a whole different feeling, man. Family, like, first.
Yeah,
that's what
family first really mean. It means grandmas that you created. You essentially, if you're in a family, you having kids, you are creating grandmothers for some other kids.
Yeah.
Ideally, you know what I'm saying? And like, and grandma's nephews, nieces, you don't know what you spawning from you busting your nut off, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I feel like
relationships.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, for real, you creating all these people with, like, this one person giving birth to another person can give birth to 15 people who give birth to 75 people, you know what I'm saying? Like, this shit can go on and on. It goes on and on and on. Of course, as you see, that's how we get humankind. And like, it's just like crazy. Like, people don't be having that mindset. Like, they be hustling for they hustle for their household. And you can't. And when you hustle like that, that's why you don't get nowhere. You can't hustle for your household. You got hustle for the whole operation. Because when you do that, you gotta. It forces you to think in a wider, like, with, you know, remember on Madden, the QB vision? It forces you to have a wider vision of things, to assess things differently. Like, when you hustle for your house, it's like a narrow vision. It's a tunnel vision. You know what I'm saying? It's narrow. You don't get to see all the other things that contribute to what you got going on. And it's okay to have that focus. You know what I'm saying? You gotta dedicate that time to yourself and have that drive. But you also got to have a leader going to have the ability to understand that it's a bigger picture. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, a lot of people I realize that, like, listen to a lot of people, they hustling for, like, yeah, when I get rich, I'm like, I don't never hear a lot of people think, like, yeah, you going to put the gang on? Like, not your friends, I'm talking about everybody, like your family. Like, is you gonna pull your, is you doing this because you tired of the way you living, or are you doing this because you trying to change the way you and your people living? Because some, when you do it just to get, just to change how you live, like this, like, I'm tired of poverty, that's not enough. Mm. You know what I'm saying? That's not really enough for real, for real. But yeah, that's something we can tap into next week, though, that whole legacy talk. Because I was
legacy building.
I was definitely looking at some stuff that had to do with that, and that's an interesting topic for real, for real. Hey, but what's this episode 60? It's episode 60 of Hippies and Pancakes.
Yes, sir.
How much time we got on here, Q?
An hour.
Oh, yeah, we looking sweet. Hey, I appreciate y'all as usual. You know, I know we got move and shake. So I enjoy this episode, man. I'm actually gonna go back and look at it. I'm actually promote this a little bit because I want people to really tap into this one. Of course, you know, Nipsey Hussle on the on the intro. DJ Q Ways, D man, I appreciate y'all time, man, every week, man.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, fellas.
Let's get it.